In an enlightened society, we would be taught differently than we were from the time we were grade school children. In an enlightened society, we would not be brought up with fairy tales when it comes to spirituality. Fairy tales are good only up to a certain point. We would be taught firsthand as to what God is, where we are in relationship to God, and it would not be through a concept of dogma, it would be through the reality of experience. Many, many years ago, when I was spending an enormous amount of time with research and meditation back in Los Angeles, we took special groups of children, and we took these groups of children and experimented in the sense of, could they actually perceive anything of a divine origin? I want you to consider this, that as we come into adult life, we come in from the source, we come in from the home base, as it were, from the other side. Our souls have been here many, many times, they're going to be here many, many more times, unless we choose to get to a point of enlightenment and go elsewhere. So it is that when a soul incarnates into this life, they are closer to the Godhead than the adults generally are. Why? Because it hasn't been repressed by intellect, and it hasn't been repressed by outer stimulus to say that this is where our intelligence has come from. In other words, a recreation of intelligence coming from an external environment. As a child comes in, they only have the internal, the instinctive environment, and by and large, that is the universal spirit that is working within us. That spirit is repressed. The more the child learns and becomes engrossed in this physical world, the more they cut off to the world from which they came, the world of spirit. And so when you take a child and you simply ask them to close their eyes, and you can experiment with this, any of you that are here, any of you that are watching at home, and realize that that experimentation can sometimes produce miraculous results. We found, as an example, if we just had a child without any type of meditational procedure, no spiritual suggestion, nothing, just come in off of the street, ask them to sit down, close their eyes, and tell us, do you see anything with your eyes closed? Of course, now this is a new thing for a child, because normally a child is very extroverted, trying to get used to the outside world again, doesn't really want to be introverted, looking inside. And lo and behold, children began to come up with pictures that they were seeing in their mind's eye that normally would be seen by adults only if they had practiced deeper forms of meditation for many, many years. What do you see? We would ask. Well, I see an angel. I see a Christ, I think. I see a Buddha. That was rather interesting, since most of these children had never heard of Buddhism. They were all here American-born. And so all of these things that possibly people would see in ecstatic vision spiritually, these children were seeing already. It meant that the mind had not repressed this pipeline to the intuitive process within the person. There are two Christianities, the one that most people know about and the other one that nobody knows about, except for a few people. The one that nobody knows about is the one that Jesus taught his disciples. He veiled it in parables. He kept saying throughout the New Testament, those that have eyes to see, let them see. Those that have ears to hear, let them hear. Because if he came out directly with the real truth, it's not very popular. People don't want to know the truth. Do you want it flat out? They do not. For all their pretenses in religion, and that includes the ministers, the priests, the rabbi, they really don't want to. Because if they did, and if they taught it, they would clear out their congregations because nobody would need them. The real truth was that Christ taught the process of going within. Why seekest God over here, over there? I say unto you, the kingdom of heaven is within you. There is no stress and emphasis in traditional Christianity. You won't hear it. Go to any traditional Christian church and ask them, why don't you talk about this thing about being within? And most will look at you, because they've been to seminary school where they didn't talk about it either, with a blank stare. Now, there are some that know about it. But those that know about it keep their lips zippered. Because if they did let it out, first of all, the average person doesn't want truth. It breaks up the reality of the myth of humanness. It puts us into a higher plateau. And what happens when you go into a higher plateau of life? You accept more responsibility. And the one thing that people don't want on this earth plane is responsibility. Nobody wants to be responsible for anything except for a few souls that come along and are the way showers and the models for every generation. And so the idea is to see beyond is to look within. And what happens when we look within? Like the children, we take a few moments, we learn how to meditate, and when we learn how to meditate, the inner part of our forehead, the inner part of our head area becomes like a looking glass, very simply. We see into that looking glass. We see beyond our intellect because we begin to pick up images, shapes, forms, scenes, realities that are over and beyond oftentimes what our intellect can conceive. It goes beyond the wildest of our imaginations and our dreams. A person begins to see into heavenly realms, heavenly celestial areas of consciousness. And we begin to realize that we can exist simultaneously in many, many different forms and shapes while we're still within the physical body. And we then get into a concept of multiple personalities, multiple existences, multiple states of beingness. If you wonder, as an example, what happens when a person is in a state of mind where they are overcome by their unconscious, i.e. they become psychotic, they can be in some type of what appears to be to the psychiatrist in some type of a fantasy world, whereas another one of their multiple selves has really kicked in, is now occupying the entirety of the person's beingness. We learn that we can exist in multiple dimensions simultaneously. Now, when I start to say that, I mean, I would lose 999 out of 1,000 people. They would think I'm goofy or whatever. That's why Jesus knew you better keep it zipped and you better speak in parables and you better not say too much. Otherwise, they won't be able to understand you. They'll think you're foolish. And it becomes down to the thing, you know, that if you say the truth, they'll render you and trample you under their feet. So what I'm talking about here is just for a few people. That's all. Literally for a few people. You want the regular Christianity? Go and get it. It's all over the place. But if you want to know the inside means that we don't look to books, we don't look to preachers, we don't look outside of ourselves, we spend time inside of ourselves for a few minutes daily, we look within, we reverse the mind in upon itself, and the mind studies itself. The mind exists on many, many different levels and plateaus of energy and consciousness simultaneously. And according to, if we're not trying to force anything, if we just put ourselves in this position to receive, according to what we're ready to receive, we will receive.